Hello and welcome to Yeyu Lab. I'm so excited again to be sharing another project with you all. As you know, I've been deeply exploring the capabilities of Google's Gemini 2.0 and its Multimodal Live API for a while through various web applications of real-time streaming interaction, including voice and video chatting, screen sharing, drawing canvas, and RAG-based QA, and also an initial version of a real-time chat app. But many of you have been asking for a mobile app version that is more easy to be deployed and more convenient to use. And I've been listening, so I spent the last few days in building a new Android app that not only duplicates the previous one, but in some ways improves the data streaming efficiency and real-time multimodal experience we've been exploring. Now I'm in the gallery, so please describe the pictures I'm seeing very briefly. And when I'm moving, that means you receive the new pictures. You just describe them one by one, okay?
I can help with that. I see three framed pieces of art in the video you shared. The first is a pink linocut print of a woman's face in profile with black background. Below it are two framed posters. One is a landscape by Paul Henry, and the other appears to be a poster for a festival at Valoris. Do you want me to elaborate on any of these pieces?
Please go on with new pictures you see.
Okay, now I see a different set of three framed pieces. The top two are the same, the Paul Henry landscape and the Valoris poster. The bottom piece is now a painting of a woman in a white top, with her arms resting on a table. Would you like me to describe this in more detail?
No, just please go on to describe more.
All right, now I see two framed pieces of art. The top one is the painting of a woman in a white top with her arms resting on a table. The bottom one is a colorful abstract print with multiple faces. Should I continue describing what I see?
Now, speaking of Gemini 2.0, Google has been very busy. Just recently, they announced that Gemini 2.0 Flash is now generally available through the Gemini API in Google AI Studio and Vertex AI to everybody. This is a big and expected step, moving it from the experimental to production-ready status. They've also released 2.0 Pro with another experimental version, which they are calling their best model yet for coding and complex prompts, and even a more cost-effective model called Flash Lite, which has been improved for quality but still maintaining cost and speed. It's great to see Google continuing to push the limits of what's possible for Gemini. However, so far, nothing in this batch released is able to support the Multimodal Live API that we mainly use in our real-time projects. Because when I look at the Multimodal Live API, it's still tagged with experimental icon in the list of the Gemini capabilities. Second, when you look at the new released 2.0 Flash model in the Gemini model list, you will see that the image output and audio output, especially the audio output that we were used to the voice interaction, is still in coming soon status. Then we will look at the Flash Lite preview version. The type of the output it supports is still text. And also when you click into the experimental model, I tried the Gemini 2.0 Pro experimental February the 5th. With the Multimodal Live API, but it's not working with that yet. So let's put these new models aside for now and still focusing on the Gemini 2.0 Flash experimental model that we used for our previous projects, which is the only model currently supporting Multimodal Live API, including the text, audio, and image input, and text and audio output in real time. Now, some of you might remember our previous Android project, which required a backend server to handle the communication with the Gemini API, just like the structure of the web app that we have implemented. It works very good, but it wasn't ideal. It added a complexity and overhead in the communication, and implementing a WebSocket server is better for commercial use if you think about a lot of backend controls and managements. However, for a personal app, only for individual assistant, maintaining a server is an additional burden. You need to keep the server running all the time and pay monthly hosting fees just to use your app. So even Google has only provided the Python SDK for this API. Our new app will get rid of the backend server entirely. It talks directly to the Gemini API via a raw WebSocket interface implementation. Another key improvement is to creating a more natural and intuitive interaction. No more manually take pictures during your voice chatting. Just hold up your phone and the app continuously capture the image, send them to the model. This is more like having a conversation with your phone where you can show it things and ask questions in very real-time scenario. Okay, now let's take a look at the code and see how this app works. I'll walk you through the main parts so you get a good idea of what's going on. In the source code, let's firstly check the activity main XML file, which is for the layout design. This file is under the layout folder under the source main of the app codebase. This is very simple layout, which includes the texture view to bridge the camera content to the preview window, image view, which is locating the status indicator icon, and three buttons, the capture button, which is not the actual capture again, but a button to start the camera preview window, a start button and a stop button for control your voice interactions, and a chat log for displaying the text, which is not fully implemented in this demo. These are all linked to the variables that we will talk about later in the main activity.kt code file. So in this file, which is the main file for our Android app, at top you will see a bunch of variables. These are used to connect to the user interface elements and manage the camera, audio, and WebSocket connection. Here you should be very carefully about the model name. We use the models Gemini 2.0 Flash EXP and the host of the WebSocket server of the Gemini Multimodal API is generativelanguage.googleapis.com, and the URL of this secured WebSockets is a little bit long. We should be very careful about this connect string with your API key acquired from the Google AI Studio. So all this communication is handled by the object WebSocket that handles the WebSocket connections with the Multimodal Live API of Gemini 2.0 Flash. The is recording is a boolean that tells us if the audio is being recorded right now. Audio record is used to record audio input from the microphone. PCM data stores the raw audio data, and the audio queue is a queue for the audio trunks received from the Gemini API, and audio track is used to play those audio responses. Now let's look at the functions. The onCreate function is where everything starts when the app is launched. We link the UI elements to the variables using findViewById method. We also set up the clickListener for these buttons. The capture button set on clickListener is what happens when you tap the capture button. It checks if the camera is active. If it is, it stops the camera preview. If it's not, it starts the camera preview. So it also updates the button's text to show the current status of the preview window. In the surface texture listener, which is important for the texture view, it listens for events like the surface become available for or being destroyed. When the surface is available, it starts the camera preview. When it's destroyed, it stops the camera preview. And then the start camera preview function checks the camera permission and then calls the open camera for preview. This function opens the camera using the Gemini 2 API and set up the image reader to capture images. The camera status callback handles the camera status and creates the camera preview session that creates a session for the camera preview, update the preview, starts the repeating capture request for the preview. Now, before we talk about anything that's sending or receive data to and from the Gemini 2.0 API, let's take a quick look at the structure of the communication with the Gemini Live API. It's important to understand this because unlike some other Google APIs, there isn't an official Android SDK for this Live API. It means that we have to implement the WebSocket connection by ourselves. There are three main types of messages: the config data called initial setup message, the real-time input messages including both the image and the voice data, and the receive messages that handling the voice response from the model. First, we have the configs message, which should be the first message when you start a WebSocket session to the Gemini, which is handled by the send initial setup message method. This is sent when the WebSocket connection is first established. It tells the Gemini API which model we want to use and how we want it to generate the response, like audio or text, in the response modalities. Next, we have the real-time input message, mainly handled by the send media trunk method. There are the messages we send to the Gemini API with our audio and image data. They are structured as a JSON as usual with a real-time input field containing the media trunks. Each trunk has a MIME type like audio PCM in the record trunk function, or the image JPEG, which generated by the process and send image function. And for the actual data, they are all formatted as Base64 encoded data. And the third important data flow is the receive message. These are responses we get back from the Gemini API. They are also JSON formatted, and they can contain either text or audio. If it's text, it's in the server content field and the model turn and the parts structure. If it's audio, it's still in the server content field under the model turn and parts, and additionally inline data, which the MIME type being defined as audio PCM rate 24,000, and the data being Base64 encoded. Also, make sure you have exactly the same text string with this. So, with that understanding of the message structures and the fact that we are handling the WebSocket connections directly, let's go back to the send media trunk function, which packages the audio and image data into a JSON format that Gemini can understand and sends them to the backend through the WebSocket. When going back to the image processing, let's take a look at the image available listener, which is triggered when a new image is available from the image reader. It checks if enough time has passed since the last image was sent. If it is, it processes and sends the image data. If not, it closes the image to release the resources. The process and send image function takes the image data, resizes it, compresses it, encodes it to Base64, and then sends it to the WebSocket, just like the voice data, with a correct MIME type. For the audio processing, there's nothing new. The start audio input function starts the audio recording process. It creates an audio record object and starts the recording. It also starts a call routine to record the audio frequently. The record trunk function converts the raw PCM audio into a base64 encoded string and sends it back to the Gemini API. The stop audio input function stops the audio recording and closes the audio record session. And there are also independent process that's handling the audio playback operations on the Android app. The ingest audio trunk to play function handles the incoming audio data by storing the new data trunk into the audio queue. Play next audio trunk takes the trunks from the audio queue to be played, and play audio plays back the actual audio data using the Android's audio trunk library. This process makes sure that the audio received from the model can be played asynchronously in a proper order and right sequence one by one. And finally, the update status indicator function updates the status indicator icon to show the connection and the speaking status. So when there's a no connection established, there will be a red arrow icon. When the WebSocket is established, the icon will show the equalizer with gray color. When you press the speak button in order to talk to the model, the icon will turn green. So that's a quick overview of the main parts of the code. It's a lot, but hopefully this gives you a better idea of how the app works. Now you can run the app by clicking the Run App button in the Android Studio on whatever the virtual device or an actual Android phone. Again, all code for this Android app is available on my GitHub repository linked in the description below. Feel free to download it and try it out, and let me know what you think in the comments. What extended feature would you like to see in the next video?